the Battle of Iraq, the United States and our allies have prevailed.
We will bring to the Iraqi people food and medicines and supplies and freedom.
Come on, fire!
We will conduct a systematic campaign of airstrikes.
We will be instituting the highest level of economic sanctions.
We will come after you and find you.
Once opened, Pandora's box can never be closed. During the 21st century, there's been no end to war in the Middle East and beyond. From Afghanistan to Iraq, and from Libya to Syria. People in these countries have endured ceaseless violence and mass suffering, never peace or stability. Are U.S. conflicts in the Middle East wars of necessity or wars of choice?
Decades of wars have left the region in tatters and have been particularly brutal on innocent civilians. People have been killed in their homes and on the streets.
شو اسمك عمو؟ انت وين ابوك؟ وين؟ وين؟ مات. شنو متريقة، متغدية، متعشية؟
Due to the war, more than 47,000 civilians died in Afghanistan. Some 180,000 to 207,000 civilians lost their lives in Iraq. In Syria, 350,000 civilians were killed. An investigation from Brown University shows that more than 929,000 lives have been lost since 9/11, when the U.S. launched its global war on terror, including both civilians and soldiers.
People is killed here in Iraq without any guilty, without anything. Also, my country is destroyed. You know, there is no electricity, no service, everything, building is destroyed.
I saw a man who was just walking in the street and they just killed him. We saw this several times, so I thought that someday soon I would be dead too, so I chose to flee.
In 2003, a coalition led by the United States invaded Iraq to overthrow the government of Saddam Hussein on the pretext that Iraq was developing weapons of mass destruction, or WMDs. The operation yielded no WMDs.
And it is true that much of the intelligence turned out to be wrong.
The UN paid a price, the UN suffered.
What ensued was years of hardship that resulted in the displacement and deaths of hundreds of thousands of Iraqi people.
Go back to the war with Mexico, go back to Vietnam and Tonkin Gulf. When we want to go to war with someone, we invent the reasons.
Indeed. What people think of when mentioning U.S. engagement in the Middle East is usually endless wars and ensuing chaos. And war, by nature, is destructive.
Their policy has been a complete disaster. I mean, it's from every point of view, this is a disaster. Obviously, the most devastating consequences are in the Middle East itself. If you take both policy after the invasion of Iraq, the civil war in Syria, in which the US was deeply involved, probably well over a million people have died. Several countries have been completely devastated.
The cost of war is high, and unfortunately, human life is the number one price to pay. Many killed were civilians. What needs to be pointed out is that those military operations were often conducted under the name of human rights or freedom. but it has often resulted in grave violations of human rights, with the most serious being the right to life.
We all know that wherever the U.S. has intervened so far, it has improved nothing. For 20 years, the U.S. deployed its military forces and established bases in the name of improvement. But the reality is that wherever the U.S. has intervened so far, it has just sought economic exploitation and left that country after a while.
The refugee crisis is another problem caused by war. UNHCR data shows that more than 82 million people throughout the world had been forced to flee their homes by the end of 2020. 1 in 9 of these refugees came from Syria or Afghanistan.
Interference and the occupation of Afghanistan have caused economic and social instability, with hundreds of Afghans emigrating on a daily basis. They flee the country under dangerous conditions.
Immigrants have to risk their lives to find a job in Iran because life is more difficult in Afghanistan now.
As many as 17 Afghans are packed into a sedan car with 5 or 6 people inside the trunk. They are then driven for hours across different Iranian provincial borders towards the central cities. So far, many accidents have happened on roads and many immigrants have been killed.
A sedan with 13 Afghan immigrants crashed into a truck. 7 Afghans were killed immediately while we took the other 6 to hospital.
The UN noted that in Syria alone, more than 13 million people have been forced to flee their homes in the past 11 years, creating the biggest humanitarian and refugee crisis of our time. More often than not, those seeking refuge in other countries are not welcomed and sometimes have to deal with discrimination and even violence.
A scramble to get food before it's all gone. There's no orderly queue here, but it helps to be small. This kitchen feeds thousands daily, many of them children. For many, this is their only meal today. Faleh, Zidan, Randa, and Dilnaz have just collected food for 4 displaced families. Faleh and Zidan are cousins and best friends. For them, food was not an issue back home in Sinjar. But since fleeing 2 weeks ago, their lives have changed drastically. Too much for some to take.
We escaped from the land of my grandfather. It was a nice place in the village. We left our homes behind and now we have to be homeless here. We had no problems before. Our house was very nice. We never wished to come here. We had to leave all my uncles behind when we escaped. We left our house, our grandparents. We left everything.
There are generally 3 problems with refugees. First, they are inconsistently welcomed and cared for, and sometimes abused. Second, many struggle to rebuild their lives, suffering from depression, poverty, and other ills. Third, many refugees also fail to integrate because they are not, in fact, immigrants who wanted to leave their homeland. Rather, circumstances forced their arrival, cut them off from friends and family, and thrust them into a place that has little in common with where they came from. Many dream of returning, many get stuck in time, their social, cultural, and professional development essentially ending when they became a refugee.
For those who are unable to escape, life is not any better. In Afghanistan, more than half of the country's 39 million people don't have enough food to eat. And young children are at risk of acute malnutrition. Nearly 23 million people are facing extreme levels of hunger, and nearly 9 million are at risk of famine. In short, Afghans are in a crisis of hunger and starvation, and hospitals are already overwhelmed with young patients.
We are facing so many problems. We have no money, and we could not afford to take our child to another hospital in the city. I have 5 children, but I've already lost one of them due to malnutrition because we had no funds. This time I sold a piece of iron so I could afford to bring my daughter to this hospital for treatment.
There is also, unfortunately, increasing unemployment, increasing poverty. The economy is suffering, and that is mainly because thousands and thousands of educated Afghans have left the country and are still leaving the country. And there is this issue of the banks not working and the restrictions on the banking systems. And you heard of the withdrawal of the seizure of the Afghan assets by the U.S. government. So a combination of factors are not working all right for the well-being and the economy of the country. That has to be corrected, and that too requires an entire Afghan decision, and of course cooperation from our friends to make it better.
Despite the repeated calls by the international community, the U.S. had first refused to unfreeze the nearly $10 billion of Afghan assets, but recently is in the process of freeing up $7 billion. But not all of it will go to the Afghans. Only half will go to a fund for humanitarian relief. The other $3.5 billion will be used to compensate victims of the 9/11 attacks. Such an unusual move has caused an international uproar. After all, those assets belong to the Afghans in the first place, and they are not really responsible for the 9/11 attacks.
Said former UN envoy to Afghanistan, Kai Eid, quote, "How low can you sink? President Biden, who wants to reestablish the U.S. leadership in the world, robs Afghan people of $3.5 billion that belong to them, a people suffering badly already. This not only hurts millions of Afghans, it further damages the image of the U.S. in the world," unquote. Member of the European Parliament, Claire Daly, has some strong words for the U.S. action. She calls it, quote, "profoundly evil and sadistic. The only conceivable motive for it is cruelty. This money belongs to Afghans, dealing with devastating U.S. sanctions and the legacy of 20 years of brutal occupation, now being stolen by the United States. An act of international banditry," unquote. Former UK Secretary of State for International Development, Rory Stewart, said, quote, "This is shameful. Afghanistan is in the deepest humanitarian crisis triggered by the international withdrawal and betrayal. Millions are on the edge of starvation. Now the US president is proposing to steal Afghanistan's own money, which could have been used to feed the starving," unquote. A relative of a 9/11 victim was quoted by Turkish public broadcaster TRT as saying, "I can't think of a worse betrayal of the people of Afghanistan than to freeze their assets and give it to 9/11 families." Endless wars have extinguished any hope for economic growth. For example, Iraq's GDP never got back to the level of 1990. Basic needs, including healthcare, have been reduced to shambles. Prior to 1990, 97% of urban dwellers and 71% of the rural population had access to free primary health care. But now, a population of 1.8 million people have to share less than 1,000 hospital beds, and 20,000 Iraqi doctors fled the country as medical facilities were destroyed.
Compared to Iraq, Syria is sort of similar in the fact that Syria's standard of living was comparable to that of Western European countries. But all that changed after the war.
We are getting shot every day! We are getting killed every day!
Stop the killing of these innocent people!
I have met a lot of Syrians who have told me that even if the war is about to be ended, that they want to leave because they have no water. They don't have the basic necessities for life. Syria was one of those states in the Arab world whose standard of living had become comparable to that of Western European countries. It was completely self-supporting in terms of food supplies, and the conditions prevailing in the field of health were fine. For instance, kids, 95% of kids were all getting vaccination. Nowadays, the situation has considerably worsened. The unemployment rate, which was about 8%, is now over 50%. The rate of growth, which was about 4.5% per year per capita, has now become a rate of impoverishment.
Looking at the situation in Afghanistan, Syria, or Iraq, one can't help but wonder, what type of human rights had the U.S. advocated?
I think it shows that the United States has got a totally false conception of human rights. It declares that the most important human right in the world is something like the question of whether you can use Facebook or not, or certain particular specific forms of democracy. And this is not true. For, as we've seen in the Middle East, for literally hundreds of millions of people, the biggest risk is to stay alive, or if second biggest risk is, you should say, is not to have to flee your country as a refugee. You know, the real criteria of human rights is how well is a human being living.
In addition to war and airstrikes, U.S. sanctions are also making life a living hell for millions of residents in countries like Iran and Syria.
Workers like me earn 3,000 or 4,000 Syrian pounds per day. With that money, you can't even buy a kilo of bananas. If you have kids, your life will be even more difficult.
Following the cessation of the hostilities, the United States has imposed very harsh sanctions on the Syrian people, targeting the weakest strata of the social society in Syria, of the Syrian society. So the poorest people in Syria, the weakest, are targeted now by the most powerful and rich country in the world, United States of America. This talks to you a lot about the human values and the democracy of the United States.
As people around the world struggle to fight COVID-19, countries like Iran and harsh U.S. sanctions face a particularly dire situation.
The direct effect of sanctions is that accessing foreign medicine is very difficult. Prices are much higher because of foreign currency shortages caused by sanctions. Foreign pharmaceutical companies do not sell us medicine because they're afraid of punitive U.S. sanctions.
I was visiting Italy, and I have a visit with a lady who is chairwoman of the medical division of Sena, and she want to help me to solve the problem. She called to many manager of many banks in Italy that why they do not accept transact between Iran and medical and pharmacologic factory. They say that we want to be in safe side when we have a deal with Iran, even for pharmacy. The CIA, they said CIA, and the USA look on us with more suspiciousness.
Several academic studies have concluded that sanctions almost never work. In fact, they very often fail spectacularly to achieve their tactical objectives, producing instead the opposite. This doesn't mean that they aren't painful, that they don't hurt people, especially the most poor and vulnerable in societies over which they are imposed. We've seen this in Iran, for example, and other places, not only during COVID-19, but also following natural disasters.
One aspect often overlooked by the international community is the impact on culture and civilization. For example, a few days after the U.S. invaded Iraq, the country's National Museum was plundered and pillaged.
More than 170,000 antiquities were looted, leading to a huge loss for Iraq as well as the Muslim world in terms of culture and Islamic civilization.
If the American forces had secured the museum a week earlier, the tragic events that unfolded here may never have happened.
The U.S. is now guarding the entrance to Iraq's National Museum. But the damage has already been done.
Televised scenes of the empty museum and the grief of the museum staff became a symbol of America's failure to protect the country it had occupied.
What was particularly disturbing were the neglected warnings that such an incident could happen. The immediate response from the Bush administration was to shrug it off as unimportant and a price for freedom.
Freedom's untidy, and free people are free to make mistakes and commit crimes and do bad things.
No weapons of mass destruction have ever been discovered. Though it was a big lie and the war was illegal, no U.S. officials have ever been held accountable for their role in the invasion. They treat it like nothing happened, a war in error. There was no accountability by the U.S., who often themselves repeat the need for rules-based international order. Fast forward to 2021, when Kabul was under a U.S. airstrike. 10 were killed, including 7 children. The investigation report by the Pentagon concluded that it was an honest mistake and no one was punished.
This strike was taken in the earnest belief that it would prevent an imminent threat to our forces and the evacuees at the airport. But it was a mistake, and I offer my sincere apology.
As I said, the U.S. bombed Kabul and other provinces many times. As we can see, this is not a mistake at all, because according to the U.S. tactical strategy, it couldn't possibly have been a mistake where the child could be seen from the aiming camera. It was a family with children and women. So what kind of mistake could it be to attack this target? So it's not a mistake. It's a war crime. Although the U.S. military admits that it has made mistakes, but now they haven't done anything for the family. Honestly, it's a war crime. America has accepted its failure in Afghanistan. Actually, America failed. Now we want the international community to demand that the U.S. military admit crimes and bring them to justice.
Similarly, the investigation of war crimes by U.S. soldiers and the CIA was conducted by the International Criminal Court. The former prosecutor was threatened by then-Secretary of State Mike Pompeo, warning that her visa and those of her family members would be suspended. The ICC decided to abandon the efforts.
Now, the ICC's chief prosecutor, Fatou Bensouda, and her top aide, Pakiso Mochokocho, have been blacklisted by the Trump administration over the court's investigation into whether U.S. forces committed war crimes in Afghanistan. Now, on Wednesday, the U.S. Secretary of State, Mike Pompeo, announced the sanctions on Bensouda, accusing the ICC of continuing to target Americans.
Today, we take the next step, because the ICC continues to target Americans, sadly. Pursuant to Executive Order 13928, the United States will designate ICC Prosecutor Fatou Bensouda and the ICC's Head of Jurisdiction Complementarian Cooperation Division, Pakiso Mochokocho, for having material assisted Prosecutor Bensouda.
It's part of the United States view. It's the United States sometimes declares its foreign policy as a U.S. exceptionalism. It's not U.S. exceptionalism, it's U.S. supremacism. What the United States says is our country, the United States, is better than any other country, so we don't have to follow other countries. Well, I don't accept that. I don't think any country in the world should think it's less good than the United States. They're all different. And therefore they have to find ways to interact, and humanity benefits from the fact that they're not all the same. And the United States is only 5% of the world's population, and if it goes around declaring itself superior to the other 95% of the population, this is a cause of great destabilization of the world, because the other 95% of humanity, quite rightly, is not going to put up with this.
One of the justifications of maintaining U.S. military operations in the region has been the introduction or export of U.S.-style democracy.
really doesn't work, because if we really want to go through change, we must go through values be respected. We must go through challenges that a country or a nation is really foreseeing. What has happened in past many decades, I think it was not only a human rights catastrophe, it's created more migration, forced migration, economical migration, cultural migration.
The U.S. Specifically uses the issue of human rights as a weapon, as a geopolitical weapon against its adversaries, while passing itself and its allies. And you don't have to trust me on that. You can trust the U.S. State Department. In 2017, the then assistant to the new Secretary of State, Rex Tillerson, he sent a memo to Rex Tillerson, who was new in the position, instructing him on how to deal with the human rights issue. And this memo was leaked and reported on by Politico. It's on the internet for anyone to see. And it specifically highlighted that the U.S. should use human rights as a club to beat its adversaries while giving a pass to repressive but friendly allies. And to quote, allies should be treated differently and better than adversaries. Otherwise, we will end up with more adversaries and fewer allies.
After decades of military conflicts, imagine how many bullets and bombs have been left behind, how weapons and armor made of depleted uranium have damaged the environment, how terrorist elements still remain and may evolve into a bigger threat, and how long nations like Syria, Libya, Afghanistan, and Iraq must struggle before they can get back on their feet. And the saying goes, if the only tool you have is a hammer, you tend to see every problem as a nail. Unless the U.S. abandons its worship of military might, we may continue to see more military conflicts. The rights to subsistence, to development, and to peace may continue to be violated.